Hey guys! Alright, lab 14. It's actually one of my favorite labs. The theory is a little challenging, so I've broken up the theory into two separate recordings, and then the actual experiment and the experimental data is in a third recording. So this is the second of three recordings. So in this recording, we're going to cover some more pre-lab information dealing with blood pressure and cardiac output. Specifically, we're going to look at, well, what is cardiac output? What factors affect cardiac output? We'll talk about something called pulse pressure, and we'll map out the relationship between stroke volume and pulse pressure. And then finally, we'll talk about the theory around how to measure blood pressure with a pressure cuff. And then I'll turn you loose on the third video, which will show you a demonstration of blood pressure measurement and give you some real data both at rest and after exercise so that you can calculate cardiac output and finish this lab. So let's go ahead and get started. So we're going to start by talking about cardiac output. Now, cardiac output is mathematically defined as stroke volume times heart rate. Well, you already know what heart rate is, so we measure heart rate as beats per minute, but stroke volume is probably a little less familiar to you. So let's define stroke volume again. Stroke volume is formally defined as the amount of blood that is ejected from the left ventricle during one heartbeat or one cardiac cycle. So this tracing right here shows you the volume of blood in the left ventricle as that left ventricle goes through its cardiac cycle. So I want to take you through it and point out what's going on. So we're actually going to start here down at the bottom after this ventricle has just ejected a lot of blood up into the aorta. So now that ventricle still has 50 milliliters of blood in it, not zero. A lot of people think that when the ventricle ejects blood, it ejects all of the blood, but that's actually not true. Much of the blood, sometimes half as much of the blood, stays behind. So in this case, we're going to start with 50 mils of blood that's left behind from the previous contraction. And then you can see that as you follow that tracing up, blood is flowing in from the atria. So remember, blood's actually coming from the left atria and just kind of dribbling down into the ventricle during this period because the AV valves are open. Now finally, we're going to have our P wave, which is here. And then we're going to have our atrial contraction. The atrial contraction is going to shove just a little bit more blood in there, so it gives it that last little bump of blood. So you can really see the atria doesn't actually do a lot. And then finally, you get your AV valves that shut here, and then you get ready for your ventricular ejection, which is shown here. So stroke volume, which is the amount of blood ejected from the left ventricle in one cardiac cycle, is really the difference between, well, what did we start with and what did we end with? So in our case, we started with 130 mils of blood and ended with 50 mils of blood. So our stroke volume is that difference, or 80 mils of blood ejected per beat. Let's actually do an example calculation. Assume for a moment that my heart rate is 65 beats per minute. Based on this equation, cardiac output is 65 beats per minute times the stroke volume. Well, if we use the amount that is generated by this graph, then I would multiply 65 beats per minute by 80 mils per beat. Well, beats cancel out, and so when I multiply across, I have 65 times 80 mils per minute, or multiplying that across, we have basically 5.2 liters per minute. So that would be my cardiac output. So what is that really telling me? That tells me the amount of blood that basically my left ventricle is moving around my body per minute. So you could imagine that if my body had a high need for oxygen, let's say I was exercising, for example, that my cardiac output would need to go up. But if I'm at rest, my cardiac output doesn't need to go up because circulating 5 liters of blood per minute is sufficient to maintain my needs. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at factors that affect cardiac output. So you know already that cardiac output is going to be stroke volume times heart rate. So how do you increase cardiac output when you need it? Well, it's pretty simple. Increase the heart rate, which you can do sympathetically, by shortening the pacemaker potential. Hopefully you learned that in your lecture already. Or you can increase your stroke volume. So in this graph here, we have the physiological ranges for heart rate and stroke volume. And so what you'll see is that the heart rate obviously increases with exercise, and I'm sure you're already personally familiar with that. But while stroke volume does vary, it doesn't seem to vary to the degree that heart rate varies. So you can see the range here going from 80 to about 100 or 110 milliliters per beat. Now, real quick caveat that I think is really fascinating. This idea of the stroke volume basically going up with heart rate and then plateauing seems to be standard for unconditioned people. In other words, non-athletes, people who are not doing endurance training. If you take a look at some elite marathon runners, then their stroke volume does something different. Their stroke volume does not plateau, but rather it can go all the way up to about 180 or 200 milliliters per beat, which is just phenomenal. Okay, so now that we've talked a little bit about stroke volume, I want to go into some mechanics about what actually could influence the stroke volume. So remember, your stroke volume is defined as your starting ventricular volume minus your ending ventricular volume. So anything that's going to increase that spread obviously is going to increase your stroke volume. So how could we increase that spread? We could start with a higher number and end with a lower number, basically. So how do we do that? So stroke volume is going to be influenced by the amount of blood that we start with in the ventricle. It's also going to be influenced by the force of the ventricular twitch or ventricular contraction. And so, in fact, as part of the sympathetic stimulation on the contractile cells of the heart caused the twitch to become shorter and stronger, generating a more forceful contraction, so that would eject more blood and leave less behind. The time of ejection, in other words, how much time is the blood actually spending going out of the ventricle versus time that the ventricle is generating tension but not actually ejecting blood. You might recall that phase is called the isovolumetric phase of ventricular systole. So again, there's a period of time where the ventricle is generating force but is not actually ejecting blood. And you could imagine that if that period took too long, and then you just got your little bit of ventricular ejection and then the twitch was over, you wouldn't be ejecting as much blood. And then finally, the resistance in the arteries is going to be key. The higher the resistance, the more difficult it's going to be to push blood out, and so you won't push as much blood out. What we're going to do now is we're going to take a look at something different called pulse pressure. So we are going to be measuring blood pressure, and before we get started on this next part, I'd like you to pause the video and look up the definition of pulse pressure. So go ahead. Okay, hopefully you looked up the definition of pulse pressure. What we're going to do now is play a quick video that demonstrates how we calculate pulse pressure. We're going to calculate pulse pressure by first looking at the pressure tracing of the aorta as it rotates through the cardiac cycle. So this image here shows the aorta as it goes through the cardiac cycle, very similar to the drawing of the aorta that we saw in the Wiggers diagram. So the top part of this pressure tracing is going to be the systolic pressure, and the bottom part is going to be the diastolic pressure. So based on this drawing here, the diastolic pressure is about 75 millimeters of mercury. Systolic pressure is about 125 millimeters of mercury. So pulse pressure is calculated by taking the systolic pressure and subtracting the diastolic pressure. In other words, it's the difference between the peak and the valley of the artery's pressure over the cardiac cycle. So in our case, it's 125 minus 75, which is 50 millimeters of mercury. So that's the pulse pressure. Now we're going to take a look at the pulse pressure for a different tracing. Imagine if the artery looked more like this. So this is a much flatter curve. So the diastolic pressure is 100. And the systolic pressure is probably about 120. And so when you calculate out the difference, you have 20. Okay, today's lab asks you to calculate out cardiac output both at rest and after exercise. To calculate out cardiac output, you would need both your heart rate data and your stroke volume data. Well, heart rate's pretty easy to measure, simply your pulse. Stroke volume is a little more challenging because it effectively requires that we take a peek into your left ventricle and say, how much blood are you ejecting per milliliter? Obviously, we have no feasible way to measure that in our standard educational laboratory. So it turns out that pulse pressure can be used to approximate stroke volume. Okay, this is your favorite diagram in the whole world. It's called the Wiggers diagram. Hopefully you've already seen it in the first video. So what we're gonna do is take a look at some parts here, and I've actually got the new part that we talked about earlier in this video superimposed. So there's your ventricular volume that we looked at earlier, and then here's our favorite parts, which are the ventricular pressure and the aortic pressure. So in the first video, I mentioned that ventricular ejection won't start until the pressure in the ventricle exceeds the pressure in the aorta. And so you can see there's a dashed line there that denotes the difference between the isovolumetric contraction and the ejection. And when we follow that dashed line down, you can see, in fact, that is the beginning of where the ventricle starts dumping the blood out. And then where does it end? It ends when basically the pressure in the ventricle falls. And this is where the semilunar valves shut here. And so then you have no more ventricle blood being ejected, and you can see coming down into this region, yep, you're at the end of your ejection, and then you start the process over. So let's take a look at another video that kind of describes this. Okay, so in this video here, I'm simply gonna just use a drawing pad and draw over it. So that marks the beginning of the ventricular ejection, because this is gonna be where the left ventricle pressure exceeds that of the aorta. Okay, and we know where the end of that blood ejection is going to be. It's gonna be right there. Again, that's because that's when the pressure of the ventricle falls below that of the aorta and the semilunar valve shut, and that marks the end of the ejection. And of course, we know this is the start of the ventricle contraction, and then the end ventricle contraction, or the end ventricle volume. And we know that the stroke volume is going to be the difference between those numbers. So as we already said, the difference between them is going to be 80 milliliters in this example. Started with 130, ended with 50, we have 80. Okay, but now what happens if my aorta shows a much flatter line? In other words, it has a small pulse pressure. So I'm gonna go ahead and draw that. In this case, I have a pulse pressure that's probably about 10. In other words, the difference between the systolic number, which is 120, and the diastolic number, which is 110, is only 10. So this aorta has a very low pulse pressure. So again, I'm just picking a different aorta number, sorry, a different aorta line, and showing you it has a pulse pressure of 10. Now the important thing here is where the crossover between the ventricle pressure and the aorta happens. Notice that the only period where you would be ejecting blood is outlined with that black bar. The amount of blood that would be ejected would be less than 80. So your stroke volume is going to be less. So in this way, pulse pressure actually is used as an approximation of stroke volume. Now it's not perfect, but we can use it because there is a relationship. The greater your pulse pressure, the greater your stroke volume. I mean, that's basically the relationship that we're setting up here. Okay, now that we've done that, let's turn and look at our final piece for this pre-lab, which is looking at blood pressure. We know that the aorta pressure oscillates with each cardiac cycle. We've seen that diagram a number of times already, and I'm showing it to you here again. But what we're trying to do is figure out what that top number is. In other words, what is the artery pressure at its peak, and what is the artery pressure at its lowest point? And that represents the systolic and diastolic numbers of your blood pressure, respectively. So when you hear people take their blood pressure, you hear two numbers, like 110 over 65. So again, those numbers represent the peak and the valley of the aortic or the artery pressure over the course of the cardiac cycle. So in this picture here, you can see that the peak is going to be at 120, so that would be the systolic number, and the diastolic number is going to be the valley, which is down here, which is 80. So how are we able to measure these? So what we're going to do is we're going to wrap up somebody's brachial artery in a pressure cuff, and we're going to apply so much pressure that it squeezes the artery off entirely. Now, when that happens, and you squeeze that artery off entirely, there's no more movement of blood through there, and it's silent. So now what we're gonna do is we're going to slowly release the pressure. And as we slowly release the pressure, and so you can see that here, the pressure is being released, then blood will start squirting through, but only at specific times. So here, when the blood pressure in the aorta is still below that of the pressure cuff, then there's no sound. But then once you go over that, you get a little squirt of blood. And then again, the pressure cuff squeezes shut, a little squirt of blood. The pressure cuff squeezes shut, a little squirt of blood. The pressure cuff squeezes shut, etc. And those cyclical squirts of blood that you hear make a knocking sound, like, when you hear that knocking sound, you're actually in between your systolic and your diastolic pressure. And so you keep letting the pressure out of the pressure cuff until eventually the pressure cuff exerts too little pressure and the blood starts just flowing through all the time because there's more pressure now in the artery than there is in the pressure cuff, and the sound goes away. So going back to this picture here, we exert pressure, no sound. We start letting the pressure out. Once the pressure in the cuff starts dropping below the systolic number, little bits of blood squirt through and create a lot of what's called turbulent flow, and that's what makes that sound, that pulsating knocking sound. And then as you continue to let the pressure out, eventually the blood is always has greater pressure than the pressure cuff is exerting, and therefore the blood is flowing through in what's called a laminar flow. Laminar just means straight, and therefore there's no more sound. Okay, so that is the theory of how you take blood pressure. So systolic blood pressure is measured when you first start hearing that little pulsating of blood. It'll start faint, and then it gets louder, and then it gets faint again as you get down here. And again, when you hear that last sound before it becomes silent again, that's when you measure your diastolic pressure.